from where we left. So last time we introduced the concept of the S matrix, which is a matrix, a unitary matrix that maps the states that lives at time equal to minus infinity to the states that lives at time equal to plus infinity. More importantly, it's not the most general state, it's the state that is basically an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian at plus or minus infinity, and it's represented by free particles that basically propagates at infinity. Okay, and then the generic matrix element of this matrix, so just copy the formula we wrote last time, so it's S matrix, and the general form of this matrix is a sum. Well, you can write it in a shorthand notation as a time order product of e to the minus I, the integral in dt from minus infinity to plus infinity of the interaction Hamiltonian, the function of t and t. And you can, for QED, this was just the term order product of e to the minus I, plus I, depending on normalization, e, the integral in d for x of psi bar a slash psi of x. The integral made over all space and time. And you can now write this formula explicitly as a power series, as a sum over n. Oh, let me write directly for QED, it doesn't matter, it's I e to the n over n factorial, the integral in d for x1, d for xn, of the time order product of psi bar a slash psi at x1, ... psi bar a slash psi at xn. So the probability amplitude for a process to happen between time equal to minus infinity plus infinity is just the matrix element of this operator here, between the in and the out state. So computing the probability amplitude reduces basically to compute a matrix element, or n of them, depending on what order in perturbation theory you want to go, of the form. Here there will be some n particle state in the out state, and then there will be a time order product of psi bar a slash psi at x1, psi bar a slash psi at xn, between the in state, which is some different, for example, n particle state at time equal to minus infinity. Then you plug it inside here and compute that to what you want. So everything reduces just to compute this matrix element. These are the fields of the free theory. So you can write each of them in terms of a linear combination, some integral of creation and relation operators, A, Dagger, C, Dagger, and so on. And here you have the external states with the n particles.
Are you recording?
Yes.
Okay.
Thanks. Okay, so in general, this computation, if you make it brute force, which means just replace to each of these fields creation relation operators and then compute each tense, it's very, very, very long. Even if you go to the first order, say like two, three vertices, for each of these psi you have two operator, either creation or animation. So you have two times two times two, it's eight. So you already have eight combinations for each of these operator. If you put two or three, it becomes order 24, not 36, depends on terms. And then you have to start contracting each of them with the standard states, so you have to do all possible combination of commutators. So it will be like if you do all the, if you start taking C and anti-commute and pass on the other side, it will go like the number of terms you have here factorial. So, so if you do it in really brute force, it will take a lot of time. So there is a some shortcut. And so this is what I'm going to describe now, to how to make more, a little bit more efficient. Okay. Well, to do that, let me remind you some identity that we got in the past. So you remember that if you have two creation alienation operators, so now for capital A and B, I identify each of either of these creation relation operators, either C, A, D, or A, O, or A, dagger, any of them, okay? So you have a product of two, and you take a normal ordering. That was also equal to the product minus the, its vacuum expectation bar. Remember, when you have two of them, the normal product was equivalent to subtract to that product its vacuum expectation bar. This means that the product itself can also be written as the normal product plus the its expectation bar in the vacuum. For example, just remember, if you have like if this A and B were A daggers, then you can always write A dagger as the normal order of A dagger plus the vacuum expectation value of A dagger. In fact, A, the normal order in A dagger A, and this A dagger is also equal to the commutator of A dagger because A dagger A and the vacuum is zero. The commutator is just A dagger minus A dagger A. So minus A dagger A cancel with this, A dagger matches with this. Similar for C, C dagger, now anti-commuting, this will be the normal ordering, which is A dagger A. Sorry, the normal ordering of C, C dagger, which will be minus C dagger C, plus the vacuum expectation value of C, C dagger. Remember, this is also equal to the anti-commutator of CC dagger on the vacuum, because C dagger C on the vacuum is zero. The anti-commutator was CC dagger, which is equal to this, plus C dagger C, which cancels with this. So, so this is the general formula for any product. Then, another thing we commented in the past, maybe I'll remind you, if you have a time order product of a normal order product of a product of n creation and alienation operator of any kind, this object here is also equal to the time order product of the original product. So if you perform first a normal ordering and then a time ordering, time ordering wins. And this is because normal ordering will reorder this this product, but then you have to take the time order after, so you reorder again, so whatever ordering you did with the normal ordering will be undone by the time ordering. And similarly, if you have a normal ordering of a time ordering, It will be in normal order, exactly. So the last wins, okay?
Of course, they are all orderings.
So the last operation do undo the previous one. So now I can use this identity here with this. Okay? And this implies that if instead of AB I had the time ordering of AB, then here we'll have the normal ordering of the time ordering, right? But the normal ordering of the time ordering is the normal ordering. So again I have normal ordering of AB plus the vacuum expectation value of the original product, which was a time order. So plus the time ordering of the product. So I can write the time ordering of two operators as the normal ordering plus its value, its expectation value of the time ordering. I can start seeing the Feynman propagator up here, okay? So these are our just set of identities that we will use soon. So this is the two main ones, okay? This and this. So clear? Questions? Okay, so now that we have all the elements, I will discuss a theorem, so-called Dick theorem. So to define what the theorem say, let me introduce first the definition. I call contraction of in a normal ordering, which I indicate with the following symbol. If I have a normal ordering of a product of A1, AN, let me put AJ, AK, AN operators. So I have a product of creation and reaction operators, N of them. I take a normal ordering. A contraction of this normal ordering, which I indicate like this, like a line that contracts two of these creation relation operator. This is just a definition. It's by definition is the normal ordering of the same string of creation relation, the same product, without the two operators that I'm contracting.
Contracting means the expectation value of vacuum.
Yeah, this is what I'm going to define. What does it mean? It means that I remove from the normal ordering and I pull them out into the indeed the expectation value in the vacuum with a plus or minus sign in front. Actually, I say a minus sign in front elevated to the number of permutations that I had to perform between anti-commuting operators in order to bring out these two operators from this string out here. So if they are all commuting operators, or A dagger, B B dagger, there will be a plus. If some of them are fermionic operators, then in order to move them from here out, I will have to perform some permutation So if I, every time I permute two fermionic operators to bring out these guys, I add the minus sign. So eventually I can have a plus or minus, depending if I had to do odd number or even number of permutation to bring these two guys outside. So this is my definition of contraction. When I would write this term here, what I really mean is this guy here. Okay? This is a one contraction. Okay, so this is the definition. And now we come to the theorem. What the theorem says is the following. If you have a product of n creation annihilation operator, A1, AN, this product is also equal to the sum over all contractions and all type of contraction, all number of contractions of the normal order product of those operators, A1, AN. So what does it mean, a sum over all contraction or all number of contraction? It means that from by this I mean the normal ordering of A1 AN, which means zero contraction, plus normal ordering of, for example, A1 contracted with A2 and the other non-contracted, plus normal ordering of A1 contracted with A3 and the other non-contracted, and so on, plus the normal order product with two contractions, which means A1 contracted with A2, for example, and A3 contracted with A4, and the other non-contracted. All possible contraction, all possible combination with two contractions, three contractions, four contractions, until you cannot contract anymore. So this is the theorem says that any product, you can always rewrite it as a sum of all possible contractions, number of contractions, all possible combinations of the normal order product. Okay? Do you believe it? Well, it's very simple to prove. In fact, if here n is equal to 2, which means you have only product of 2, we already proved it. The proof is this. So you see that the product is a normal ordering with zero contraction plus the case with one contraction, which is just you contract, you pull out, you are left with an identity. Okay? So all we have to do now is to prove it for all the other cases. And as you may imagine, in this case, the proof can be done by recurrence. You assume that it's true for a product of n, and then you can prove that if this is true for a product of n, it will be true also for a product of n plus 1. Since we already proved that it's true for 2, the proof will follow. Okay, I'll just sketch the recurrence, right? So let's say you take product of n. Let's do n plus 1. So I add 0 in front. So I assume that the product of a1 to an can be rewritten in this way. I add now an extra operator in front. And now I will prove that if that is true, it will be true also with the product of A3. Okay, so here we have two cases. A0 could be either a creation or an annihilation operator, either A or W. Let's do the both cases. Let's assume this A0 is to start Let's see that this annihilation operator. Okay. Okay, then I can now start and rewrite the first product, A not A1, as A1 A not, and then there is all the others. I'm using now this identity here. I write it as the normal ordering. Since A0 is annihilation, the normal ordering tells me that A0 must be on the right, plus the contraction. So plus A0, A1 contracted, and A2, AN left. Okay? Then I take this guy here, and now I consider the product A0 and 2, and I use again this guy. So this I also write as A1, A2, A0, and all the others. So I exchange these two, because they are normal ordered, plus the contraction of A0 and 2. So plus A1, and now A0, let me write it also here, contracted with A2. Of course, every time I exchange this, I have to be careful. There could be a sign me minus if the word in doing this operation I exchange the two fermionic operators. So every time I permute a fermionic operator with another fermionic operator, I add the minus. And same from here and so on, because I take it from here. And of course, I can continue the same procedure until you end up with the original product and A0 at the end. And in doing so, you'll get a sum over all contractions which involve A0 with any of the other guys. Okay, this is if A0 was an annihilation operator. You see that what you do, you get something that was the normal ordering product between the whole operator and A0, plus all possible contraction A0 with the rest. But the rest itself can be written as a normal ordering product plus all type of contractions between them. So if you have, so at the end you get something that is a sum of normal ordered products with all possible contraction between A1 and 0, plus all the terms that involve any contraction at 0 with the rest. So you really get all possible contraction between all operators. And this is if A0 is an annihilation operator. If A0 is a is a creation operator, then you will say, oh, wait, is this a creation operator? This is already normal ordered, because this creation operator is an A dagger, it's already in the right side. But I can write, again, like this, I can write A0 as itself, which is already normal ordered, plus I can always add contraction of A0 with any of them, okay? Because the contraction of a creation operator with any other operator is vacuum expectation value, which is zero automatically, because a creation operator on the right of the vacuum is zero. So I'm basically rewriting this expression as itself plus a bunch of zeros that I can always do. But now, in doing so, I write it manifestly as a normal order product plus all type of contraction that involve a zero with all the rest, like in this case. So independently, if a zero is a creation annihilation operator, the full product can always be written as the normal normal order product with all possible contraction. And this ends the proof.
You consider all operator either harmonic or bosonic. There is no mixing.
The only difference between bosonic and fermionic is a minus sign every time you permute two fermionic operators. Of course, the contraction between a fermionic and a bosonic one is automatically zero. Because if you take the Huygens Cartesian line, one fermionic and one bosonic. Also, if you any contraction between two harmonic oscillators which are not, which is whose commutator is not, is trivial, will be automatically zero. Because the commutator between like a scalar field and a vector field will automatically be zero. Or the contraction between two and a dagger and A with two different moments, also zero. The only non-zero contribution you get when you have a dagger A with the same P, the same polarization. You have to create and annihilate exactly the same particle, otherwise the matrix element on the vacuum will be zero. So most of the contraction are automatically zero. Any question? Is it clear? Is it not? You want me to repeat? Silence.
If we look at the expectation value of this product, A1 to AN.
Yes.
All the time will be zero. Okay, those with compact.
If you take the expectation value on the vacuum of A1 AN, so if you use this theorem, then you'll get normal ordering with all possible contraction. It depends here what type of creation and deletion operators you have. It might be zero, it might be not. Of course, if you take on the vacuum, this guy will be zero, and this guy will be zero. The only guys that have a chance not to be zero are those where all the things are contracted, and you'll be left with exactly nothing left on the normal ordered part, because the normal ordered product on the vacuum is zero. Any other questions? Doubts?
So, you had another number of operators, and you can.
On the vacuum, you get zero.
Okay.
Yes. Also, if you have a different number of creation and annihilation operator on the vacuum, it's zero. You really need to have exactly the same number of creation and annihilation operators with exactly the same P so that you can contract them all in something that is non zero, and then on the vacuum, you get zero. But actually, the expectation value of this guy on the vacuum is not what we'll be really interested in. Because if you put the vacuum, eventually you want to use this guy, this product, this theorem, to compute S-matrix elements. Or processes with some initial particle, some final particle. The process with the, you start with the vacuum, end up with the vacuum, is not that interesting. So the vacuum arises from using this theory of non-trivial external states, because the parts that involve the contractions are actually expectation value on the vacuum. So that is where the vacuum come up. Okay? Okay, so this is a theorem. Of course, we are not exactly interested in the generic product of A1 AN. We're interested in the time order product of A1 AN, which enters in this matrix. But using the properties we wrote before, the theorem is easily extended, because then, if you put here a time order product, of course, what happens is that here you have a sum of all possible, a sum of terms which are normal ordering, because you have normal order or time ordering, which is normal ordering. But now the contractions are, like in this case, time order. So if you have a time ordering product, this can be written as the sum over all time ordered products, time order contractions, of normal ordered products. So which means that when I write this guy here, so for example, when I write this guy here, what I mean is that you have a normal order product without these two guys, and these two guys are just a time ordered product on the vacuum. Exactly like in this case.
Aspect should only be time ordered,
because
time and normal ordered together.
Which one?
I mean,
this. This is normal ordered. So the original theorem was this. Now I consider time ordered. So here is normal ordering of the original guy. So it's normal ordering of time ordering. And so when I do the contraction, it will be time ordered. But the guys that remain, that are not contracted, I have to take normal order or time order, which is normal order. So it's a normal ordering of all time ordered contractions. The time ordering only survives in the contraction because it's not normal ordered. The guys that are not contracted are normal ordered. So what the generic form of this matrix element that we wrote before. So you remember this matrix element, the generic matrix element at any order was some I e to the n over n factorial, sum over n. Well, let's put n fixed, okay? You work at some order. So this is, if you want, is the out S matrix in. The N stands for the terms at N order, okay? Only take the term which has N powers of the coupling. So I have N products of the interaction of Hamiltonian. This will be of this form, will be some integral in D4X1, D4XN. And now we have the matrix elements between in and out of the time order product of the interaction Hamiltonian. So each of these will be interaction Hamiltonian. So by using this theorem, this will be a sum of terms which have some number of time order product of, let's say, A with A, or time order product of psi with psi dagger, and so on. And then you'll be left with the out n order product of all the other operators that survive, some psi, some a, some psi bar, here, blah, 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 and instead. some of the creation and nature operators inside the fields are time order contracted, so those give you factors which are the value expectation value of the time ordering, times the rest of the fields, the creation and nature operators which are not contracted, will be left in the normal ordering, of which you take the matrix element between the in and out state. So, and then you here you sum over all time order contraction. So this is a general form of the final matrix element using the big theorem. How is this helping the calculation? Well, it's helping the following fact, following sense, that most of the terms I'm writing in this sum are now manifestly zero. The only terms that are non-zero, that you have to write down, are those for which here, since this is a normal ordering, in order this term not to be zero, it must have exactly the right annihilation operators in number, A, C, D, which annihilate all the particles in the in state, and exactly the creation operators that you need to create the particle in the out states. If you miss some of them, you have extra of them, this matrix element will be zero, because you are normal ordering. So if you have more annihilation operator than this, you get some annihilation operator on the vacuum, give it zero. If you don't have enough, you'll be left with some initial particle here, which is not annihilated, and it will be general orthogonal to some final state here. And same for the creation operator here. So you basically have to take your initial product of interaction Hamiltonian, select all possible fields that you need to annihilate or create the initial and final state, and contract all the rest. Which means it will give you extra factor here of time order product of the contraction. Only terms of this kind can give you a non-zero contribution. And these are much, much less than the one that you could write by brute force, by just writing all possible combinations, all possible products in the field. There is a non-trivial feature that the Big Theorem highlights in quantum field theory. That is, you see, the general transition amplitude between an initial state and a final state is such that to it it contributes everything that is not protected by a symmetry. So if you have a generic in state and another out state, final state, which have whose basically evolution will not violate any symmetry, so have the same charge, the same energy, so that a process from an evolution from that state to the another state will not violate any conservation of charge, then you'll have a non-zero contribution, because from the Big Theorem you see that you have to sum all possibilities. So in general, we'll always have a term that will contribute to it, unless it's forbidden by conservation law. So this basically summarized by the statement you may find in the literature that say that everything that can happen in quantum field theory will happen. Unless it's something is forbidden by a symmetry, because the theory tells you that you have to contact all possibilities, unless this, you find exactly zero, then you'll have at some point, you'll have, since you're here, you have a sum of infinite number of terms. If you go to arbitrary large expansion in decoupling, at a certain point you'll find, you know, zero. So maybe to clarify a little bit how this procedure works, let me give you an example where we will see exactly how to use this theorem, the Wick theorem explicitly, in a simple case. I will not do the full computation, but I'll just show how. Computation work, and then so imagine, let's select some process. For example, let me say that we want to consider the case where our in state is a state with one electron and one photon, and our out state is again a state with an electron and a photon, but let's say that it's a different state. For example, the momentum of the electron is different, the probability of density is different, and the same for the photon. Okay? So I'm saying that, for example, the electron has momentum p1, the photon has momentum p2, the outgoing electron p3 is p4, maybe this is electricity h1, this is h2, h3, h4, okay? So they are different states. We want to compute, which is the probability amplitude, that this electron and photon coming from minus infinity will end up being an electron and photon with different momenta and different electricity, okay? Then this probability amplitude then is just the matrix element of the S matrix between this in and out state. And let's say that we want to compute this at the second order in perturbation theory, which means we choose n equal to 2. You can show that this is the first order where you get a non-zero contribution. N equal 1 is not enough. We'll see this. Just now take n equal to 2, just I want to do an example application of that procedure. So our S matrix amplitude will have a factor IE square over 2 factorial, right, this expansion of the exponent. And I have an integral in d4x1, d4x2. And then I have to take the matrix element between my out state, which is E minus gamma, P3, P4, so on, time order product of psi bar A slash psi at the point x1, and product psi bar A slash psi at the point x2. And then I put my in state, which was E minus gamma with momentum P1 and P2. This. Okay. Okay, so we have to consider this matrix element. So according to the theorem, the only non-zero contribution will be those for which I do not contract the fields that will be left from outside. So it means that, let me consider all possible contraction first, okay? Let me consider, if I do zero contractions, then I'm dead, because it's zero contraction means that I get just a normal ordering of this. But now you see that I have four fermions. One I can use to annihilate the electron, one I can use to create the electron at the end, and then I'll be left with some extra C and D dagger, normal ordered on the vacuum, I can see. So I have to do at least a contraction. In particular, I have to do at least a contraction of fermionic field. So that at the end, one photon field I will use to create, annihilate the internal and external photon, one fermionic for each for internal and external photon, and the other fermion I contract. Okay? So I can contract, now I want to contract, basically I consider contribution with one contraction of fermionic fields, but I have several. So I can contract this with this, or I can contract this with this, or I can contract this with this, or I can contract this with this. Okay? I have to sum over all possible contractions. So I have four contributions. And the guys that don't contract, I leave it as a normal order. Okay? Let's see. This and this I'm not going to consider because we will see that they give zero. One way to avoid them is to start with the normal order Lagrangian. If you start with the normal order Lagrangian, this will give you normal. Since these are normal ordered, their contraction of the vacuum is zero. But you see that they are zero anyway. So for the moment, let's ignore this guy. So let's ignore the contraction that come, that start and finish on the same point. Then I'm left with two contributions. But these two contributions are the same. Because you see, this guy is a contraction between psi and psi bar between x1 and x2. The other one is the same contraction with psi x2 and psi bar at x1. But you see, this guy here is the same as this guy here if I exchange these two vertices. But since I'm summing, integrating over x1 and x2, right, the integration is symmetric under exchange of x1 and x2. I'm ordering here. So if I contract this or I contract that, I get exactly the same result. So I get twice the result with one contraction, and these two actually simplify these two here. And it's not actually an accident. Here you have an n factorial, if you remember the original formula, and you have n integrals of something that is permutation invariant under the exchange of the vertices. In fact, you remember we created this n factorial exactly because of this. So when you do your computation, the same factorial always simplifies away if you basically by permutations of the position of this object there. Okay, so at the end of the day, we have only one contribution to care about, which is this contraction here. So this contraction will give me a contribution which is a time order product of on the vacuum of psi at x1, psi bar at x2, which was our Feynman propagator for the fermion. Okay, so let me use the formula. Then I get, put only one and this goes away, I get I e squared, the integral in d4x1, d4x2, the vacuum expectation value of the time order product of psi of x1, psi bar of x2, which is our contraction. And then all the other fields which are not contracted needs to be normal order. So I get the matrix element between E minus P3, gamma P4, normal ordering of psi bar a slash taken at point x1 and for psi bar a, sorry, no, then a slash psi at the point x2 e p1 gamma p2. Okay. So I have a normal order of the operator that are inside here. Now, in this normal ordering, this electron can only be annihilated by the C operator which is inside Psi, because Psi bar doesn't have C, only have C dagger and D. Okay. So I use the C inside here to annihilate the electron. So the electron go here is annihilated by Psi. And similarly, Psi bar, I can only use Psi bar to create an electron. So I use the C dagger inside Psi bar to create the electron, which then escapes to infinity. Okay. Now for the photon, however, I have double choice, because each of these A has an A and A dagger, A and A dagger. So I can annihilate this photon either by using this A here, and then I use the A dagger here to create the final photon. And this is one possibility. The other possibility is that instead I use this guy to annihilate the original photon. And then it means that I have to use this, the A dagger here to create the final photon. So in this normal ordering, if you write explicitly in terms of C dagger, A dagger, you get two contributions. One corresponding to the contribution when you take A dagger A from these two, and the other one you take A dagger from these two. In normal order. So this guy, we know, is a function. It's like a Bessel function with the gamma matrices, blah, 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 in terms of x1, x2. And this, after you do the contraction, it just gives you, remember, in this, there are some integral in D3P, but then you use the commutation relation with the final state. It will give you just some factor, which is e to the I, p, x, 2, e to the I, p, 2, x1, blah, blah, some factor. So this will give you some exponential. This will give you some two-point functions, some functions, some Bessel function in x, then you take the integral, and this will give you the probability amplitude for this process. So you can conveniently represent this object here, pictorially, in the following way. You see, here you have, let's consider the first contribution down here. Here you have an electron and a photon which are annihilated at the same point, x2. You also have that the final electron and photon are created together at x1. The incoming electron and photon, this is outgoing electron and photon. Time goes in this direction, for example. These are the accretor at x1. And then there is contribution of a fermion that from the vacuum is created at x2 and is annihilated at x1. So it's created at x2 and is annihilated at x1. This is called Feynman diagram, and it's a pictorial representation of one of these contributions.
Is it Compton scattering amplitude?
And this is correspond to a Compton scattering amplitude, I mean a scattering between light the photon and emit. But this is not the only contribution. We said that there is also the other contribution where you exchange the photon creation condition operator. So here you see the topology is a little bit different because the electron is still annihilated, the incoming electron is still annihilated at X2. But the original photon is actually annihilated in a different point at X1. So this guy is actually annihilated here at a different point. Similarly, the final electron is created from X1, and the final photon is created at X2. And still, there is a fermion propagating from X2 to X1, which is this way. So you see the topology of this diagram is different from this, and it corresponds to the second contribution to this process. And in fact, there is a one-to-one correspondence between all the possible contribution you have from the big theorem to a S-matrix amplitude and the possible diagram you can draw for the process called the Feynman diagram. In fact, the computation of this probability amplitude can be recast in simply rewriting the most general Feynman diagram you can write according to some rules that we are going to see more in detail next. And there is a one-to-one correspondence between each part of this diagram and each part of the computation. So this diagram is not just a pictorial representation of the process. It's actually, to each diagram it corresponds a formula, one-to-one. So each diagram is a numerical contribution that you can add and get the final result. So in this language, basically, computing the scattering amplitude, the probability amplitude of a process corresponds to just draw all the possible diagrams and then read from the diagrams the corresponding formula, corresponding integral, which will give you the final answer. So if you want the statement from the big theorems that to sum over all possible contractions, all possible combination of the normal ordering, correspond in this language here to draw all possible diagrams that you can draw with the fixed initial and final state and with fixed structure for the vertices. So you see the vertices here correspond to the point where you insert the interaction Hamiltonian. On each vertex, on each point, x1, x2, xn, you have this, in this case you have the same operator, psi, which contain two fermions and one photon. So two creation annihilation operators of fermionic kind and one creation annihilation operator of boson side. Which means that for each vertex, you will be attached to two fermionic lines, in this case the continuous straight lines, and one photon line, which here is the wiggly line. So all the vertices will have this structure here. And okay, here we draw the initial and final state as incoming and outgoing lines of the kind associated to the particle you have in the initial and final state. So you could have got exactly the same result, but just assuming that there is an electron incoming, a photon outgoing, an electron outgoing and a photon outgoing. Then you want to study this at the second order in perturbation theory, which means you have to add two vertices. So one vertex here, one vertex here. And then you try to connect all the lines in all possible way you can. Okay, let's do this. So this electron can be attached either here or here. But you see, if I attach it here or here, it doesn't change because there is a permutation symmetry between these two guys. These were the two permutation symmetry, the two contraction of the electron. So let's choose one of them. Then from here you have to go out Well, either you go out here, but if you go out here, this has to contract with itself, which was the contraction we didn't consider on the same point, which will give zero. So for now, not consider this, like before. So let's contract this with this. And then this must go here. There's no other possibility. Now we have the two photon lines. And you see there are two possibilities. Either you connect this with this, and this with this, and you get this diagram. Or, or you connect this with this, and this with this, and if you flip it, you get this. So there is a really a one-to-one correspondence in just drawing the most general diagram you can write with the rules that I mentioned before and doing the weak theorem. It doesn't matter how you draw your diagram, if it's like this or like this, because on each of these two points, you have to integrate over. So at the end of the day, the final answer will be integrate over all possible positions of all the vertices. So what it matters is just the topology of the diagram, not where you draw.
For
the weak theorem. The weak theorem is pretty old. I don't know. I wasn't there. But most probably they were doing brute force, and then soon they realized they had to find a better way. And then they came up with the weak theorem. Also Feynman also came up this pretty early. Any other questions? Time flies. Okay, so now let's go a little bit more in detail on all the rules to draw all the diagrams and how to associate to a generic diagram a formula, right? And try to simplify that formula the most. As we will see, at the end you'll get these rules that are pretty simple and give you some relatively simple final formula for the amplitude, at least at low order. Of course, if you go to higher order, you're starting putting more and more vertices, which means that you have to do invent more and more type of contractions, and you have also more possibility to contract, so more and more diagrams. In fact, the number of diagrams, in any case, the number of diagrams will grow factorially with the order of perturbation theory. So you do typically a first order, you get one or two diagrams, and then if you go to second order, third order, fourth order, fifth order, you can start having like 10, 100, 1,000 diagrams. Okay, so the rule is pretty simple. The general rule is that you just draw the original and final line according to the process you're interested in, right? If you have incoming electron, incoming photon, outgoing electron, going photon, positron, antiparticle, same. And then you start putting in vertices, like we did here, n vertices depending on which order you want to consider the process. Okay? And then you start contracting in a possible way, like we did. And you get a bunch of diagrams. Now we want to associate to those diagrams some formula. So first of all, what kind of diagrams you can generate? general, you could end up, if you have a bunch of initial lines and final lines, with diagrams which are called disconnected. Right, you have even different ways of disconnected diagrams. Let's say you have some process here like this, but you have a very high order, so you get also some diagrams like this. Okay? Each vertex has two fermions and one photon. You have, for example, here you have three electrons, which scatter into three electrons, but then you have start having like diagrams which are disconnected. This diagram you can neglect, then with disconnected pieces, because all they do is just to reface the vacuum. What does it mean? Let's consider the simplest process amplitude, the one actually you asked about. I could consider an amplitude of this matrix. Instead of a non-trivial in state and out state, I put the vacuum as an in state and a vacuum in out state. This corresponds to the probability amplitude that you start with the vacuum and you end up with the vacuum. Well, this probability the probability better be 1, right? If you start with the vacuum, you want to end up with the vacuum, because otherwise it means that the vacuum is not stable. Which means that the matrix element between the vacuum and the vacuum could be at most a phase. So that the probability, which is the modulus square of this, is 1. But what Feynman diagrams correspond to this guy? So these are the Feynman diagrams with zero incoming legs and zero outgoing legs. So there are Feynman diagrams which are called bubble diagrams, which are similar to this I draw here. And actually, you can show, not too difficult, that if you resum all this diagram, you get just a phase. In fact, for each diagram you can write, let's say you start with this, which is the first non-trivial diagram. If you have this diagram, then you also have a contribution which is twice this diagram. Also, you have a contribution which is three times this diagram. And so on. So whatever this diagram gives you, if you resum the full series, and if you put the right prefactors, you can find that this series resum in E to the bubble diagram. And the bubble diagram is purely imaginary, so it gives you just a phase. And this is true for any actually, how complex this diagram is, you will have also the contribution from this. The Weak theorem tells you that you have to sum all possible cases. If you have this, you automatically also have twice this, you have three times that, and so on.
Good,
so you always resum.
You are considering good order, the part of the ratio of S.
Yeah, you have to put all orders. Only when you put all orders, you resum, you get this. Otherwise, you get the Taylor expansion of this. So the phase starts with the, since the first contribution to the phase comes from interaction, is proportional to some power of E. This phase here will have some power of E, like E square alpha, electromagnetic, blah, blah, blah. So if you do perturbation theory, you truncate, you have to expand this, you only don't find the full exponential. Only after you resum, you find the full exponential. But at the end of the day, it's just a phase. So this guy here, now in any process, you will have also contribution coming from this guy. So this guy here, these bubbles here, all they do is just to, it's just an overall phase to the process. This overall phase does not depend on this part. It will be the same independent of this. So which means that at the end, your probability amplitude is defined up to a phase. So you can always factorize away this phase coming from here by dividing by this phase here. So you can safely neglect all this type of disconnected diagrams because all they do is just give you an extra phase to the probability amplitude, which do not depend on the initial final state. because you have this diagram without this, plus the same diagram with one, plus the same diagram with two, and after you sum, you get the same diagram times e to the alpha. Okay? There is another class of disconnected diagrams, and are those for which a situation of this kind. You could have a process where a subpart of the initial and final state factorizes. So this part of the diagram is disconnected by this part of the diagram. This can only happen, however, if you see there is an energy conservation, energy momentum conservation of the process. So we will see that these amplitudes are non-zero if and only if the energy momentum and total angular momentum of the initial state matches with the final state. If these guys are disconnected, what happens is that this part conserves energy and this part conserves energy because there is no, they are decoupled, right? So this diagrams correspond to the following process. You have like a scattering in plus and minus, for example, here, another scattering there, and they are spatially separated, they don't influence themselves. So energy is conserved there, energy is conserved there. But this is not a very interesting question to ask, because the answer will be just a product of the probability for each of them. So we can just restrict to the simpler case where there is only connected part. Because the other is like a spectator to this process.
Like hadron decay?
Huh?
Like hadron decay?
Almost. In hadron decay, it's an approximation that you do that they factorize, because there is always some small contribution which exchange, but typically it's very small, so you can neglect it in a first approximation. But if you take this momentum exactly equal to this momentum, then they really factorize. So we can basically, typically you can just consider processes where you have only connected diagrams. All the rest are simply products of this. Okay? Then another rule is that the 1 over n factorial that you write in front, you can remove it because it accounts to labeling this diagram with x2, x1 versus x1, x2. It's just the permutation of the x's, right? So the 1 over n factorial we put at the beginning of the things correspond to the whole n factorial permutation between the labels that you put or x1, xn on each vertices. So you can write the Feynman diagrams without x1, xn, and don't write an n factorial, just consider it once, okay? Instead of considering all possible contribution x1, x2, plus x2, x1, and then you divide by n factorial. Okay? Then, simple. Each internal line of a diagram, like in this case, this one, arises from a contraction. Because it's a line that contracts, that connects one vertex to another vertex. You remember, the vertices were the insertion of the interaction Hamiltonian, so they are the line that connect two of them is a contraction. So, which means that for each internal line, you write the Feynman propagator corresponding to that line. In this case, a fermionic Feynman propagator. If you had a process like this, you put the photon propagator between these two points. So for each internal line, it corresponds to a Feynman propagator. So in that case, well, I don't know. Let me write. So if you have a fermion line in x1 and x2, this will correspond to the integrand d4p over 2 pi to the 4 I over p slash minus m p to the minus I p x1 minus x. This is a numerical factor function that corresponds to this line. If you have photon line, which connects, let's say, mu with mu. Remember, each vertex you have either a mu or a nu. Then you get I the integral mu for t over 2 pi to the 4 minus g mu nu over p square p to the minus I p x1 minus x2. These are for internal lines. And then you have external lines. Okay, let's imagine that the external line is an incoming electron. This will correspond to what? This will correspond to a phi. This is x1. This will be the field psi at x1, which acts on the incoming electron. You remember here there was the integral in D for T3p over 2 pi cube, 1 over 2 omega p, up, c, pr, or h, e to the minus I px. And then here you use this C. The electron was a C Dagger vacuum. C Dagger vacuum is equal to anticommutator, which was equal to 2 pi cube, 2 omega, the delta 3, which erases this integral. At the end, you get a factor which is UP, H, where P and H are the momentum and the velocity of the final state, of the incoming state. So. And then the exponent. E to the I, so this is a minus I p x1. So for an incoming line of an electron with momentum p and velocity h, you get a factor which is the spin will tell you the information about that electron and an extra exponential factor for the momentum. You could have had an incoming positron at the bottom, right? We didn't have it there, but could have processes with incoming state at the bottom. So in this case, in order to annihilate the antiparty, we need a D, which is the D operator, right? Which was inside psi bar. So in that case, in the normal order, you have to use psi bar of x1 on the positron, the momentum p and h. So in that case, if you repeat the same exercise, you get something very similar. You get, now here, you get the d bar ph, because d is with v dagger, there's a gamma naught inside psi bar, so you put v bar. And again, you get e to the minus I p. Finally, you can have a photon incoming, like in that case, momentum p, polarization epsilon. This is means that you're using a mu of x1 to annihilate the incoming photon. So you have to use the a inside here. A will also multiply epsilon p. So this give a factor which is epsilon p, which is the polarization epsilon mu. This is a mu, epsilon p mu h e to the minus I p x1. This is the polarization of the photon. We have the information about
where the psi get is the information, you know, equation, the sign of the positron electron.
The what?
I mean, your arrow sign.
Sign? E minus plus?
No, the, I mean, your external the arrow sign, yes.
The arrow, you remember, we used the direction of the arrow follows the charge. So I use the arrow follows the particle, E minus. So it go opposite for antiparticle. So this could indicate just electron coming in this way or a positron in this way.
So this information can be seen from there.
From where? From here?
Yes.
Well, I use it science bar.
Okay.
Here is the standard state is E minus. Here the standard state is E plus.
That's why in case of photon there is no sign.
Yeah, because it's its own antiparticle, right? Same, I'm not writing here the rules for the scalar fields, which might be an exercise, which I'm easier because if you understand this, the scalar field is resulting in polarization, so it's just, okay. But for example, exactly like in this case, there is a difference if you have a real scalar or a complex scalar. A real scalar, you have only A's, A daggers, the particle is equal to antiparticle. So the line for the scalar, for a real scalar, usually has no arrow, exactly like the photon, because there is no charge associated to them, they are real. Instead, if you have a complex scalar field, by convention you have an arrow that follows the charge, so the particle will be associated to an arrow that goes in the same direction is the momentum. Instead, the antiparticle will be associated to an arrow which goes opposite direction of the momentum because it's a different negative charge. So the current is anticorrelated with the velocity.
A question. And on the right hand side, should we have a cat or not?
A what?
A cat.
Yes. Cat. Yes. The vacuum.
Of course, in the rule, at the end, the vacuum for the in state will erase with the vacuum in the out state, so you never write it. So in the rule, you just write this factor here. Okay, so these are the incoming state and analogously for the outgoing states. So if an electron goes away from the point, let's say x2, then the outgoing electron will be created by psi bar at x2. And this leads to the factor which will be u bar p. H e to the I p x 2. Now, because it's a creation operator, there will be a plus in this point.
You forget the vacuum.
And I forgot the vacuum again. Okay. And if instead you are producing an antiparticle, then here you have E plus, then it will be created by the field psi at x2, and here vacuum. Now here, the creation operator will have, for antiparticle, will be a D dagger inside psi, which multiply V of P and H. E to the I P x 2. And finally for the photon, if you have a photon coming out from the point x, the final photon will be created by again a mu of x. In this case, the factor in front of a dagger here will be epsilon P mu H star e to the I p x. All the lines, either internal or external, incoming and going. And then all you have is line and vertices. So the vertex will be this, and is associated to which factor? Well, each vertex will have a factor which is IE, you know, there's I to the n, E to the n. Then in the vector was a psi bar, psi, gamma mu, psi and mu. Psi bar and psi and mu, we already used them either in the contractions or in the normal order. So all you will be left will be just a gamma mu factor, which we didn't use anywhere. The gamma mu will bring the mu index, which will be the mu index of the photon line here, which will be either the mu, if an external line, of the epsilon mu, or one of these indices mu or mu, depending on where it is attached, of the propagator. Because a mu is either part of the propagator or part of the external line. But gamma is a matrices, there will be also two spinorial indices. These spinorial indices will be the spinorial indices of the fermions, of the incoming and outgoing fermions from the vertex, and depending if they are internal or external lines. If they are internal lines, these indices will be contracted with each of the indices of this fermionic propagator, which is a matrix, if you remember, or with the fermionic index, if it's an external line, which are attached to the spinorial vertices of the external fermion. How to contract the spinorial indices? I will say soon. A little bit of patience. I will finish before some time. No, it's not long. Almost. There's something else. Remember, there was an integral in d4x for each vertex. So for each vertex, there was an integral in d4x. So this, for each of these vertex, there is an integral in d4x. Now x appears very simply, right? It appears only in the exponents. So if this vertex has some internal line, you'll have some e to the ipx from the internal line. Or if they are external line, again, it will be some e to the ipx of the external line. So the integral of this for x will be an integral of e to the I p1 plus p2 plus p3, the sum of the momenta associated to the vertex, times x. There is a plus or minus sign, depending if the momentum is incoming or outgoing from the vertex. You see, if the momentum is incoming to the vertex, there is a minus. If it's outgoing from the vertex, it's a plus. And also here, you get one with a minus and one with a plus, corresponding if the momentum is outgoing from this vertex or incoming in this vertex, and so on. Which means that if you orient the momenta all in the same direction to the vertex, you have either all plus or all minuses. So for example, if in this vertex I orient all the momentum incoming to the vertex, for incoming moment I have minus, so I get this integral here, but this integral is just the factor 2 pi to the 4 delta 4 of the sum of the momenta, which just ensure that four momentum is conserved on each vector. So you can actually perform the integral in the 4x directly, and this will basically fix the momenta on the lines. So on the standard line, the momentum is fixed by the momentum of the incoming line or outgoing line, depending on your matrix element. The internal line, you had some integral in D4T, so you were integrating over all momenta. But many of these integral can be removed by using this delta function to get from the conservation of momentum. So for a generic diagram, you could assign momentum to each segment, to each line, and so on. On each vertex, the momentum is conserved. The external momenta are fixed by the process you are considering. On internal lines, you have to integrate over momentum, but you have to conserve momentum on each vertex. So now, depending on how many vertices versus how many lines you have, you could have either more delta functions or more integral. Okay? So if you have more delta functions, fix all the momenta. All the integrals therefore P could be removed by using delta functions. If instead you have x more internal lines, you have more integral in D4P, some of the integral in D4P will stay. This problem of determining how which integral momentum stays or goes away, it's equivalent to determining basically in a circuit whether the current on each leg is fixed by current conservation or not. It's exactly the same problem. And there's a simple formula to determine this. So if P is the number of propagator, which is the number of internal lines, and V is the number of vertices, P minus V minus 1 is equal to L, which is the number of loops. What is a loop? The number of loops is basically the number of cuts that you can perform on a circuit, on a diagram, which will maintain the diagram connected. So a diagram like the one which we saw before, like this, has a zero loop, because whatever leg you cut, you will disconnect the diagram. Cut this or this, disconnect that. So this is zero loop. But for example, you could have a diagram like this. And here you could cut here without disconnecting the diagram. So this is the maximum number of cuts you can perform without disconnecting the diagram is the number, is the so-called number of loops. In this case, you will say that this diagram is one loop. So if you add like a diagram like this, you can then perform two cuts and it will be still connected. So this will be called two loops, and so on. Now you see that the number of propagator is the number of integral in D4P. And the number of vertices is the integral in D4X. Is the number of delta functions. So the number of loops counts the difference between the number of integral in D4P and the number of delta functions up to 1. So this one here is a delta function that you always be left with, which is the delta function associated to the conservation of the four momentum between the sum of the initial state and the sum of the final state moment. So one delta will always be the conservation of the initial and final, because a conservation on each vertex. That one do not depend on the internal momenta p, so you have to remove it. And all the rest basically counts in this formula. So you see that if you have zero loops, the number of delta minus the number of the delta of the conservation of all the momenta matches with the number of integrals in D4P, which means that you can remove all the integrals in D4P using all the delta that you'll be left with. So for zero loops, all the integrals goes away. All the momenta in each leg will be fixed by conservation of momentum, and basically you're done. So for example, in this case, you have P1 and P2 here. Conservation here tells you that this leg, which was P5, must be equal to P1 plus P2, because momentum is conserved here. This, if you call this P3 and P4, means that this guy must also match with the sum of P3 plus P4. So if you see this object is over-constrained, it must be equal to P1 plus P2, must be also be equal to P3 plus P4. This is only possible if P1 plus P2 is equal to P3 plus P4. This is the delta of conservation, the plus one here, the delta of conservation of total momentum that you can factorize away. And then, after you do this, basically all momenta in all legs are fixed, which means that the integral in D4P5 was here can be completely removed by one delta, and the other delta is the conservation of all momenta. Instead, in this case here, loop equal to 1, you can see that there is always some momentum that is not fixed by energy conservation. After you choose all the momenta in this loop, in this diagram, you can always add a circular P. You can always add a momentum, same momentum to all these legs here, without affecting any conservation momentum in each leg, because you're adding and removing the same momentum on each vertex. So it don't affect the conservation momentum, but then it means that there is a degeneracy, there is an undetermined momentum P. This undetermined momentum P from the conservation of momenta is the leftover integral of the D4P that you have to perform. So for each loop, you'll be left with an extra integral in D4P that you perform over the unfixed momentum P that you will get from energy conservation. And you can prove this easily by recurrence again. Instead, draw the easiest diagram. We just add the internal lines and prove it that if it's true for the simplest one, it will be true for the next simple one. So
actually, in case of loop, it will return its path again. So
it will do what?
In case of loop, it will return its path again. So it will be expressed as green function of zero, right?
No, it will be a product of green functions. These are different points, right? x1, x2, x3, x4. So you will get like s of x1 minus x2 times s of x2 minus x3, and so on. Only if you have the contraction the same, then you will have s of 0.
Contribute in the final tables?
Maybe yes, maybe not.
Maybe.
In QED not. and we will see this.
Yeah.
But in other theories, there are contributions from tuples.
In other theories,
like the standard model, the vacuum expectation value of the Higgs is a tuple. So it receives correction of that kind. I guess we are basically done. This is the summary. So you draw your diagram. For each incoming line, you add these factors. Outgoing lines, you add these factors. Internal lines, you add, if you want, only this factor here. Vertex, this one. And then you have an extra. It will be one delta function for the conservation of all the momentum. And then there will be extra integrals in D4P for each loop that you have in the diagram, if you have loops. If you don't have loops, you're done.
When you determine the vertex, three vertex, did you put up three beams? I mean, three lines, external line. How did you determine it?
Determine.
I mean, how did you get that?
This formula.
Yes.
Yes. So you remember, this guy was coming from this. This object here, right? Mm-hmm. At some point x1. So I used psi bar, psi and a mu around here, depending if it's internal or external line. What I'm left is gamma mu here. There also say an I e in front for each way. Okay, next time we will rewrite all I wrote directly in momentum space with all the integrals done, and we'll tell you more details how to contract all the indices, how to summarize all the rules, and then we're done.